the info. I'm your host, Antonio. What you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. And what you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you've been told of yourself. Yes, well, you know what? This is February, and I'm looking at that weather going down the next week or two. Not looking too bad for February. Not looking too bad for February. You know, I guess, yeah, we're in the Super Bowl weekend and all that good stuff, but that's all right. You know, but we hanging in there. Hang on there, hang tough. You know, I just want a quick announcement. You know, we lost one of our good brothers, I guess about a month or so, two back. They're having this memorial today. Thomas E. Roper Jr., good friend, colleague, co-worker. So, you know, I just want to put a shout out to him and all his friends who maybe couldn't make the funeral, the memorial today. So, you know, he was well turned out, and they're giving him a good home going, as they would say. Yeah, so we got a great show for you today, but in the remote studio, we got Brother Vince Robinson. What's going on?
Well, it's 28 degrees. I'm looking at the weather forecast right now, and it's saying on Wednesday we're going to have 52 degrees, and on Thursday we're going to have 52 degrees. Next Monday, and I'm saying Monday after next, 43 degrees. So you might think that we're turning the corner, but you know what's going to happen. March is going to come, and we're going to get another, we ain't out the woods yet, you know.
Yes, yeah, absolutely, boy.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, so, but, you know, just going along with your comments about Brother Roper, I just want to say goodbye to another legend here in Cleveland, Mr. Eddie Backus Sr. They had his homegoing ceremony on Monday. It was a beautiful occasion, brother, beautiful occasion. And some of his colleagues showed up to pay honor and tribute to him. You know, one of the jokes, there were two jokes that were told about Eddie that I found quite amusing. One was that he was good at bowling. And so they went out one time, and Eddie Backus actually picked up a split. Now, you know, for those of us who can see, that's quite an accomplishment.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the other joke that was funny about him, and I can't remember if it was Kamal Abdul-Aleem or whether it was Joe Desjardins, but he just talked about, you know, how Eddie had this van. And, you know, people would drive the van for him. So one time they got into the van, and Eddie said to the driver, "Let me drive."
Drive, yeah. But that's like you say, it's a legend as far as the city is concerned. So,
Okay. So we don't normally do this, but every once in a while, we have an opportunity to do this. I got a message from Rhoda Cantrell, and she wants me to let everybody know that the Tuki Buki film from Senegal is going to be shown on the 24th of February at 8:30 p.m. and 8 o'clock on the 27th at the Cinematic. It's a Senegalese film. Apparently, it's been out for a while, but it is, I guess, a historically and culturally relevant piece. So I just put that out there, Rhoda. Now everybody knows. You can go to our Facebook page and get more details about that. So with all of that said, we're waiting for a call from our guest, Bayyinah Bello. She is a professor and she's a linguist. And I'm telling you, she participated in an event that you staged last year over at Wings Academy. And the presentation that the sister came with was just completely off the chain. So much valuable and beautiful information. We've had her as a guest on before, so we're really looking forward to the dialogue that we can have with her when she calls in today. Just share with us, you know, what your thought process was, what you would like to bring with her today.
Well, again, you know, I had my series going on, Show Me the Money, but, you know, I was reminded, you know, by myself, that in the sense that this is Black History Month. I was like, okay, let me give our people a little, you know, history. We never can get enough of that, you know, because so many, you know, years it's been abstinence, you know, meaning that we haven't been getting the good history, the proper history, you know, the history that really, you know, have an account, you know, for what our contributions have been to this country and to the world. So I decided to, you know, hey, let me bring some good energy, some good knowledge and about history. And then, and you know, places like what we're going to talk about today, like Haiti, you know, and, you know, that's something that, you know, it's a shame. We got to be grown to know exactly what happened. You know, we got to be, you know, I'm speaking for myself, you know, older, and for you to get some of this valuable information and as far as encouragement. Now, one thing I want to just talk about while we're waiting on Sister Bell. A lot of times, you know, some people, and I don't know if you received this, Vincent, it's been out there, you know, I can see in the mainstream sometimes, when people say, well, you know, you guys talk about your history and stuff all the time. Is that you're doing it just to make you feel better or to just, well, no, I'm doing it because I know how important history is. And I know how important it is for people to feel better and good about themselves. And this country has done so great of a job, you know, making you feel like you had no contributions to the civilization at all. So, and I know how important knowing, you know, and feeling good about yourself, how to, you know, the self-esteem that you get to, you know, that to make a person do better, want to do better. And so, you know, it's, you know, just like when we come on, what you do for yourself depends on what you think of it. So that's why it's so important that we got to talk about it. It's not to try to overshadow anybody and make them think that Africa and the black people are so much better, you know, but it's the point of, people went through a whole lot to make us not feel any good about ourselves. That's what I'm talking about. And that's why we need to continue to talk about our history.
Earlier in the week, I watched a video that was put up by this young brother. I think he might be in New York. I don't know exactly where he is, but he calls himself Black Magic. And he did an interview with Professor James Small. And Professor Small was talking about history and the importance of remembering. Even when you look at the word remember, and he broke it down beautifully, we'll have to have him back at some point to even talk about that. But as you so eloquently put, you know, it's important for us to know our history so that we can know ourselves. And when you erase mm-hmm. a person's history and your knowledge, their knowledge of themselves, then you put them in a position where they can be controlled because you make them feel lesser than yes. what they are, you know?
Yes, absolutely.
Madame Barishade, Dr. Adetokunbo Barishade, talks about it all the time, and one of her favorite historical figures is Imhotep. And when you look at what Imhotep did and the profound influence that he has had on the entire civilization of this planet, if you had any inkling that that was a person that look just like you, it would make you feel a certain kind of way, because you could then imagine the possibilities. If you had an iota of the knowledge that brother had, what would you be able to do? It's so important for us to know ourselves and to know our potential, to know what we are capable of, so that we don't languish in mediocrity, so that we can, you know, live within our purpose and do the things for each other that support the success of our race and the success of the entire world. You know, this entire world yes. is mm-hmm. based on the success that black folks have had. I mean, if this is Black History Month, let's just talk about inventions. We've done this on shows in the past. I can recall being in the studio with you down on Carnegie, and when you pull out a sheet of paper and it would have all these,
yeah.
all these, you know, yeah. it's like you enjoying that cold beverage. Well, thank a brother, because the brother invented the refrigerator. You like that ice cream? Yeah. Well, guess what? We invented the ice cream. You enjoying those potato chips? Well, guess what? It was one of us yeah. that did the potato chips. You like absolutely. Teeing your ball up when you go to the golf course and you want to put it 300 yards down the middle? Well, thank a brother, because a brother invented the golf tee. I mean, we could go mm-hmm. on and on and on. You pull up to the intersection. You know, there's a traffic control device that's there thanks to a brother named Garrett E. Morgan. See, so we have all mm-hmm. these things mm-hmm. that we can look at. We're going to take a break real quickly and hope that our guests will give us she'll
be calling. I just gave her the number. She'll be calling in a second.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll just remind the listeners, you're listening to 360 Info Network right here on AM 1490 WERE. I'm Vince Robinson along with Hamtonio. We'll be talking with Professor Bayyinah Bello in just moments. Hang with us. We'll be right back after this.
Hi, I am Frances Caldwell, Executive Director of the African American Museum, welcoming you to join us as we continue to rebuild, grow, develop, and help the community. In addition to the rich historical exhibits we have, we are offering community education, cultural opportunities to enhance our children, including free dance and business classes. The African American Museum celebrates over 60 years as America's oldest independent black museum. And as our founder, Ichabod Fluellen, intended, we are heading for higher heights and renew community education, history, and culture. You can contribute to the success of this valued institution by becoming a member. To make your $35 yearly membership pledge, Cash App, $AAMCLE. For more information, please visit our website at AAMCLE.org or call 216-721-6555. Thank you for your support of Cleveland's African American Museum.
Greater Cleveland's largest selection of African fashions, African art, jewelry, picture frames, and African furniture accessories from the heart of Africa are located at African Art, 16700 Chagrin Boulevard, Shaker Heights, Ohio. Give them a call at 216-269-7421. Enjoy their spacious showroom and gallery and enhance yourself in your home with African art and cultural clothing, fine art, home and personal accessories. For a limited time for our 360 Information Network listeners, for every $50 purchase, receive a free handcrafted African fabric mask for personal wear. Our quality is impeccable and our inventory will meet your need. Open Mondays through Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Enhance your life with African art.
Welcome back, 360 Info Network, with your hosts, Hamtonio, and yours truly, Vince Robinson. We have been joined by Professor Bayyinah Bello. She's an Afro-descendant, our historian, educator, writer, and humanitarian with over 50 years of wisdom and extensive research. Professor Bello specializes in Haitian, our story, and linguistics. She's taught in many parts of Africa, Haiti, and America from the primary to the university level, including the State University of Haiti. She is the founder of Foundation Felicite, named after the Empress Consort of Haiti, and wife of the revolutionary leader and founder of Haiti, the Empire of Freedom, Jean-Jacques Dessalines. Welcome to 360 Info Network, Professor Bayyinah Bello.
Thank you. That is such a fine introduction, and every word so well pronounced. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I work hard.
Greetings to everyone.
Greetings.
Yes, greetings. Professor, you know, it's unfortunate that we don't look at, like we should, Black History Month, or telling our story, you know, 365. But, you know, we tend to gather most people's attention during this particular month. So I decided to bring you back on and talk a little bit about our history and some of the things that we need to reiterate and drive home on some of the historical things that happened in Haiti, the Haiti relationship to us in Africa, and that important date, 1804, what that's all about. So welcome to the show. And if you can impart some information to us so we can really get, the real gist of the importance of Haiti.
Thank you very much, brother. All right. And on the island of Haiti, the island carried that name, Haiti, for over 4,000 years prior to being invaded by Euro-Christians. So when the Euro-Christians invaded the island, they renamed it Hispaniola. Then they started fighting among themselves for the island. And after about 200 years of fighting between French and Spaniards, they split the island into two parts. One-third for the French, and two-thirds for the Spaniards. course, this was blessed by the Vatican for it to be accepted. So, the Spaniards kept Hispaniola for the name of their colony, and the French named their side Saint-Domingue. And from 1492 to 1804, our ancestors, Tainos, Arawaks, Siboneyes, Tupi, all of the indigenous people of the island fought to retain their freedom. But the slaughter that the Euro-Christians brought on every level, number one, weapons, but that wasn't the main thing, even though they like to pretend that's the main thing, they had superior weapons. Not true. They had weapons that our people didn't have, but our people are so much smarter. As soon as a weapon landed on the island, we grabbed a few and mastered it and take our share and continue to fight with whatever weapons come in here. So the real problem was the very presence of these Euro-Christians, because they met on the island a people who had very few antibodies, because they had known very few diseases. But they arrived with syphilis, tuberculosis, malaria, the one that gives you buttons all over. Smallpox and big whatever. Mm-hmm. They had tons of disease. Europe was a disease-ridden space. People of very little hygiene. So, when they landed on the island, indigenous people, started to die off. There are even some journals where they would say they arrive and they just talk to the people, or somebody just cough, and then 5, 10, 20 people are dead the next day. What these journals, they will not advertise them. They will not print them in millions of copies for all of us to read. So, their disease-ridden bodies was the worst weapon that they brought in. And from 1492 to 1503, barely 11 years, they slaughtered. Oh, no, we have to have the numbers of people as well to really understand. All right? They, the Euro-Christians, estimated, some of them say 2.5 million was the population. There are different numbers all the way to 10 million. But whether you take 2.5 million or you take 10 million as the indigenous population, Christopher Columbus arrived with 138 people. So that's 139 people. Then a year later, when the second round came, about 2,000. Tops, they might have been 5,000 euros. And for 5,000 to slaughter millions of people, it couldn't have been done with them guns.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We have to be logical when we're talking. It's not because they call it history that whatever he says is correct. We have to think. 139 people cannot slaughter 10 million people in less than 11 years, less than 12 years, 1492 to 1503. 1503, that's when they start kidnapping Africans and bringing them to the island, because they had practically erased the population. They claim, according to still what they say, the Euro-Christians say, that by 1503, there were but 100,000 souls on the island. If there were 2,500,000, and then 11 years later, it's barely 100,000, that means what? you slaughtered 2.5 million people in 11 years.
Wow.
5,000 people. And let's say in 11 years, they probably might have reached 10,000 mm-hmm. people slaughtered. 5 million people, except 400,000. So, this war continued. Now, they're bringing in the kidnapped African as captives on the island. We fought on the continent, before they could get us and bring us under the boat. We fought on the boat. When we couldn't fight, we killed ourselves. But we rejected slavery by any means necessary. And we continued to fight on the island. So actually, the Haitian people fought for 312 years before reaching 1804. And on January 1st, 1804, General Jean-Jacques Dessalines made the declaration. And he started by saying, I take universe as my witness as I declare this land a land for free people. No matter where somebody comes from, running away from slavery, if you land on this land, you become instantly free. So, the Declaration of Independence, of course, there's a whole text to it, but mm-hmm. two things are very important. And the first, also the first article of our Constitution, which states that we declare we will remain free, independent against all forces of the universe. This is all the armies of the planet, all forces of the universe
mm-hmm.
reject domination from any one of them. And that's where the Haiti's Declaration of Independence is a universal independence.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, there is also some place where Jean-Jacques Dessalines, General Jean-Jacques Dessalines, specified that any black running away from freedom become instantly free and a citizen. But anyone from any race, creed, or color running away from slavery lands on this island, becomes free.
See, that's you know, that's very interesting. When you said that about the real weapon that was brought over there, you know, it reminds me of a TED talk, and our listeners can go to it and put in, I think it was in South America, just a native of South America talks on TED talks about it. And that was the very thing that he mentioned with the contact of the European, what had happened to their people as well, you know. So, and it also makes me think about something, you know, our dear brother Smalls used to talk about when dealing with history and dealing with knowing who we are as far as people is concerned, and an indoctrination that happens on this in this country. About we tend to, you know, because we're indoctrinated, we tend to not to, you know, get on the wrong side of hero of history and look at the heroic deeds of the wrong people sometimes with this type of indoctrination. We should be saying how and what did these people do in order to survive and school our children based on those accomplishments to give you encouragement to move forward and then come into your own right and own God consciousness, you know. So that's why another reason why history is so important, you know. And also, I would say the language and things of that nature that connects and bonds the people. But then it seemed like Haiti went through another issue when we started dealing with the French. Could you give us just a little backdrop on that?
Okay. Well, yeah, we have to understand that in Haiti, always, that's the other thing that they always blind us to. in their narratives. Wherever one colonist is, at least one more comes to try to take whatever he's got. See, it's always a case of the thief stealing from the other thief. So okay. We have to be clear on these things. So the island was taken by and declared for Spanish. Then the French starts fighting with them. And after over a century of fighting, they sign a treaty, Treaty of Ryswick in 1675, to agree to split the island into two, each one a piece. Now, while those two were on the island, and the blacks, the Africans, were enslaved on both sides, the British were also trying to come and take it over. And in 1801, for example, the French were in very weak position because of the various movements of Africans on the island. The British General Maitland came with about 40,000 troops. And he figured, according to his strategy, within a week he should be able to take the island with 40,000 troops. So he came, and Toussaint Dessalines faced up to him. And in the end, he backs off what was the colony of Saint-Domingue, leaving on the ground over 25,000 dead British soldiers. Mm. The biggest British defeat all over America. They didn't lose that many people. In U.S., they did not use it. In Canada, they did not lose it anywhere. 25,000 dead on the ground. Mm. But that didn't suffice. They had Jamaicans, blacks, in their army. When they got off the island and got back into their boats, they put all the blacks in the same boats. And they set fire to those boats with their own soldiers. These Jamaicans came as soldiers and officers of the British army. And they fought for the British. But in the end, the British burnt them because they didn't want to take back to Jamaica blacks who would be able to talk about what they saw blacks do on the battlefield.
Mm.
In these people. So anyway, we are now 1804. Haiti has declared independent. And the Haitian people are starting to organize themselves. By 1805, we have a constitution. We create an imperial constitution. But very different from any imperial constitution from this world. Because this is an imperial constitution where the emperor specifically requested by Dessalines. Dessalines said, no, I will not accept that only people of my family can run the country. Too many of us have given our blood for it, for freedom. Therefore, the next emperor must be voted, elected. And I suggest that the first qualification should be that person's contribution to freedom. So contribution to freedom is the number one qualification to be at the head of the country.
Mm-hmm.
That's how Dessalines also crowned himself with a lot of discussion. You know, no crown. When they say, oh, no, we can send to England or France or somewhere to buy. So, no, we need the money for the people. We're not going to buy nothing. My hands brought us to freedom. My hands will crown me.
Mm-hmm.
So very different structure. No cape, no crown, no this, no that. Simple structure. Okay. So, now, we said we would look at some of the women's contribution.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the first woman that I like to look at is the woman who was there when the first Euro-Christians invaded the island. Because the island had a structure, the Arawak structure was the crown is at the head, never one person, always a crown of five. And in that crown, there must be both female and male energy. So they can have one female, four male, or one male, four females, or two, three, whichever way, but it can never be five male, it can never be five female. That was established over 1,000 years before the invasion. So at the time of the invasion, the crown was made of one female, four males, and Anakauna was that female. Within a couple of years, the Euro-Christians slaughtered, basically through tricks and lies, they killed the four males. And the woman survived for nearly 11 years and fought them. She has a sentence where she says she would pick up when they see them weapons landing on the shore. She would organize her team, go and get her share, and spend the night trying to figure out how this weapon works. And the next morning, she'll be on the battlefield using it. You know, and they would be shocked. A, where did she get it? And B, how can she figure out how to use it? You know, they always have this thing where they're smarter. They have this illusion of being smarter than everybody else. But actually, mm-hmm. when we look at the facts, we always figure their stuff out so much faster. Obviously, they're not.
Mm-hmm.
Even if we take something as simple as language, okay? Euro-Christians could land in a country, live there 50 years, and never learn the language. Whereas our people, within a few months, we know how to speak their language.
That's true.
In interaction with them.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to look at facts. Look at facts. Not recite what the books, their narratives tell us. Okay? So Anakauna was this great ruler. Even though there was a practice of war in their tradition, the Arawaks are a very peaceful people. But this instantly mounted troops to face up to the Europeans when they landed in Haiti. Now, the next woman I like to take a look at is Tontoya. This woman is from Dahomey. She was a member of the female army of Dahomey because the kingdom of Dahomey had a female had the tradition of a female army since what these people's calendar called the first century. So by the time they arrived in Africa, 15th, 16th, 17th century, when they start to interact with our folks, they were stunned to find that there is a female army. There is a female army and there is a male army. Each have their own functions. They do not work together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, Tontoya, who was an Agbaraya in the female army, the female army, when you go in, you're going around 10 years old. You have to be 10 and under to join the army. And your education is done there. Learning about astronomy, learning about history, learning about all the things you need to know in order to be a decent warrior. So you learn everything within the army training. And also healing is a must. Because you have a profession where you're going to be hurting people, you must learn the other side.
since Professor Bell, I got to stop yes. right at that point right there. I got to talk about that. Now you saying that this is a part of the trade. This is what I want people to understand. And the reason I'm stopping because I get in debates with some certain people, and I'm saying even in conflict or even when we're doing things of that nature, that it still is some type of balance. It's still some type of connection or God consciousness, and even doing things of even fighting, so even training. So you telling me a part of the training is learning astrology, learning how to heal, and that whole, I mean, it's just a whole other way of doing things. You know, it's amazing to me, you know, that, and when you compare that to this system in Western culture, because that's what I try to explain. It's a totally different mythology and an understanding and a total different approach to even war and even training, you know. So continue on, sister. I just wanted to make that footnote there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. A totally different perception of life, actually. Okay? Well, one of the things that I've come to understand in studying the Daomi female army in particular, and understood why it's so important for a soldier to know how to heal. Point firstly, yourself, when you're hurt, you can already know what to do for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
But I also realized that when you study anatomy, you can also do your fighting, healing, in a much more efficient, less painful way. Because you know exactly where to hit. That's sort of what you learn in martial arts also.
Mm-hmm.
You know how to quickly do what you want to do. You want to maim the person, then you know that's what you're going to do. You want to kill the person, then you're going to go ahead and kill the person and not have this person dragged out and, you know, but if you, that's what you want to do, you want to make somebody suffer, then you know exactly what to do then too. See? So we have to understand that Mother Nature does not judge this as good and that as not good. You take a leaf, the same leaf that can cure you can kill you. It often has to do with dosage, how much of it you take. Same for any medicine. The same medicine that will cure you will kill you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So, I understand.
It's absolutely vital that if we're learning to fight, we learn how to heal. Mm-hmm. And that was the practice. Especially, and the funny thing is, mm-hmm, go ahead.
I was just saying, and also just the balance, you know, I was having another discussion with someone and they was saying women's role is this and that's all women supposed to do. I said, no, not necessarily. It all depends on the customs and things like that. So I said, I know women that's, you know, been out to battle and fought and things like that. So I'm just tripping on to the balance of it. Still, you had the male army, female, and a lot of us don't know that some of the higher guards of like Gaddafi and a few other places, they was all, and they showed you a glimpse of that in Black Panther. They were women.
Yes.
Yes. The story is mm-hmm. being told in many different ways, and it is really edifying for us to hear what is being shared with us today, because we don't know what we don't know, but when we find out what we need to know, it puts us in a much stronger position. You're listening to 360 Info Network right here on AM 1490 WERE with Hamtonio, Vince Robinson, and our very special guest this morning, Professor Bayyinah Bello. She's schooling us on the history of Haiti, and we're going to get some information about linguistics. And one other thing before we go, because it's just gnawing at my soul. I need to find out this dynamic that we have on an island where people could come and find their freedom. But on the other side of the island, you got a completely different dynamic going on. I hope we can talk about that when we come back. Stay with us. We'll be right back after these messages from the African American Museum and African Art. We'll be right back.
Hi, I am Frances Caldwell, Executive Director of the African American Museum, welcoming you to join us as we continue to rebuild, grow, develop, and help the community. In addition to the rich historical exhibits we have, we are offering community education, cultural opportunities to enhance our children, including free dance and business classes. The African American Museum celebrates over 60 years as America's oldest independent black museum. And as our founder, Ichabod Fluellen, intended, we are heading for higher heights and renew community education, history, and culture. You can contribute to the success of this valued institution by becoming a member. To make your $35 yearly membership pledge, Cash App, $AAMCLE. For more information, please visit our website at AAMCLE.org or call 216-721-6555. Thank you for your support of Cleveland's African American Museum.
Greater Cleveland's largest selection of African fashions, African art, jewelry, picture frames, and African furniture accessories from the heart of Africa are located at African Art, 16700 Chagrin Boulevard, Shaker Heights, Ohio. Give them a call at 216-269-7421. Enjoy their spacious showroom and gallery and enhance yourself in your home with African art and cultural clothing, fine art, home, and personal accessories. For a limited time, for our 360 Information Network listeners, for every $50 purchase, receive a free handcrafted African fabric mask for personal wear. Our quality is impeccable and our inventory will meet your need. Open Mondays through Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Enhance your life with African art.
Welcome back to 360 Info Network with Antonio, yours truly, Vince Robinson, and our guest, Professor Bayyinah Bello. Before we took the break, we were talking about the role that women played in the army that defeated the British, the French, the Spaniards. Everybody came in and tried to get a piece of that island, and they walked away empty-handed. Very important history for us to understand, and please continue.
All right. So the short of it, so we have, for example, in the army, we have women. Ultimately, under King Henry, the army was headed by a woman. The general at the head of the army was a woman. So women were, during the revolution, there was no limit as to what we could do. And in the Republic created by Pétion, there is a law putting women out of public service. From 1804 to 1811, there were plenty of women in every part of public service. And then starting with 1811, women were officially put out in a wording, something that says something like, we must not go against God or nature by asking women to do more than they are capable of. Something like that. So IP is, in a nutshell, 1804, we create the Empire of Freedom. And IP's name is spelled H-A-Y-T-I. The Empire of Freedom, at the head of it, Emperor Jacques and Empress Félicité. Then King Henry, General Henry, he became head of state, did a kingdom in the north with the same spelling, H-A-Y-T-I. Alexander Pétion took to the west and south and created the Republic of Haiti, H-A-I-T-I. That's the spelling most people know. We have three spellings. We have the Arawakaino, A-Y-I-T-I, which is today used in the Haitian language, which people call Creole, and I-T, the kingdom, the emperor and the kingdom, which is H-A-Y-T-I, and then I-T, the republic, H-A-I-T-I. But on the same, this island has known such a rich history in every way, shape, or form. And it is important to understand it. We also the only people in the Americas, as far as I know, who all have minted their own money. We did that in the 1800s. Haiti minted her money in gold and silver coins and did it so well that several South American countries asked us to mint their money for them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Today, we've gone so far backwards as unnecessary paper money is being sent to different countries to print for us. Yeah. I mean, we could mint gold and silver, and now we send away for printing.
Professor Bello, I'm compelled to ask this question, and please excuse me for interrupting. And because we've talked extensively about the history of Haiti, and we've also talked about the role that women have played in it, I just want the listeners to have an awareness and an understanding of what's going on right now, because right now history is actually being made. The island of Haiti is an island that includes another country. And when you look at the perception of Haiti around the world, we think of it as an extremely poor place. We think about all the poverty and all pretty much negative stuff. You know, that's the narrative that they want to be put out there. But what you're sharing with us is that the people there were ahead of their times, and they were doing things that caused people to come to them for the advances in technology or awareness of, like you said, how to coin money and whatnot. What resulted or what caused this division in this island, and how is it that you have two completely different perceptions? I mean, people go to the Dominican Republic to vacation, but you don't look at of Haiti as a vacation spot. So could you just give us an understanding of how this duality of that location happened and what the political ramifications and implications are?
Okay. Number one, remember I said everyone tried to have Haiti, the island. Okay, first, Haiti is the island for over 4,000 years. Now, once we after fighting the British, the French, and the Spaniards, we on January 1st declared the island independent. We established the islands as a free. But then, but we were most of us, those who did the fighting, were mostly on the west side of the island. And so on the other side, as we were setting up structures, Spaniards and French and other Euro-Christians start to come back to the eastern side. And then at some point it was, in fact, some of our people on the eastern side asking Haitians to please come and free them because they had reestablished slavery on that side. So Boyer was the president at the time when they asked for rescue. So we went back to the other side of into the eastern. I have to say that the geography makes it difficult, the two sides, because there's a lot of mountains and rivers between the two, those two areas. That's why. That's one of the natural separations, you know. But mostly it's because we don't have people who think outside of a colonial education. Is why, you know, the unity of the island has never been properly taken care of. But for 21 years, the government of Port-au-Prince run the entire island. And again, more, what you call that, you know, colonists and slavers never give up. That's one of their strong points. You have to understand that. If they lose the battle today, they go back and recoup. If one colonist lose, then they have to put their heads with two other colonists whom they fought before in order to recoup that, they will do it. So then French and Spaniards took back that other side, and after 21 years, after that particular president fell out, then the Spaniards, we established themselves on that side again. So it's a lot of back and forth that has created. But mostly we have to understand, because Haiti, black nation, who assume her blackness, stood up and say, to be black is to fight for freedom. That's what black means. To us, it's not to the liberators. When Dessalines went in the Constitution, we say every Haitian is black. Whether your eyes are blue, your skin is white, your hair is blonde, we don't care. You are black if you are Haitian. Not Haitian, you're not black. So people say, but why do you despise? How do you make a difference? You know, what is black? Black are those who fight for freedom. The men redefine what is black, what is freedom, and what are the values in this world. The number one value is freedom. And so on that basis, that entire colonial slavery world was against Haiti. For 56 years, no country recognized Haiti's independence. Every country was doing something to undermine Haiti. The French continued to try to figure out how to put us back in slavery. And let me tell you, in 2004, in Canada, the G7 met to declare to see how they could eliminate Haiti's independence. 2004.
That is,
the war against Haiti has just begun.
That's unfortunately
where most Haitians are unaware.
Yes, that's something that we definitely need to have some more conversation about. But unfortunately, our time has run out on it. So we're going to have to come back and revisit this issue and perhaps have more than an hour to talk about it, because there's just so much that needs to be said. Professor Bayyinah Bello, thank you for joining us on the radio program this morning. We look forward to continuing this conversation at a future point in time.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you to all those who honored me by listening. And we hope and pray that if you learn anything, the value of it is to apply it in your life. Be blessed. Be protected by the divine sitting inside of you.
So well said.
Thank you, sister. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And I can honestly say that Cleveland has definitely been blessed this morning, and not just Cleveland, because people are able to see this and hear this around the world. So once again, thank you for joining us, and thank you for sharing your wisdom and knowledge with us. You've been listening to 360 Info Network right here on AM 1490. This is Vince Robinson along with Hamptonio and our guest this morning, Sister Professor Bayyinah Bello. Again, profound information shared with us. We'd like to invite you to visit our website, and that is 360 Info Network Radio. .net. You can also check us out on Facebook. We have a 360 Info Network Facebook page, and we post prodigious amounts of information on that webpage and hope that you can take advantage of that as well. We'd like to thank our engineer, Tristan Sanchez, for pulling everything together and enabling us to have a quality radio program right here on AM 1490 WERE. With that, know yourself, love yourself, be yourself, make today your best day. Cleveland and the rest of the world, peace.
Peace.